been trying to do something that's challenging my parenting abilities. I've been trying to teach my five-year-old to swim. I don't know if you went through that. Maybe you hired it out. Some of you who weren't willing to get in there and get your hands dirty, you took them to swim lessons. I'm not doing that. We probably will. I will give up at some point and we will end up in swim lessons. But right now, we're going to the Y. We've been going all winter with my youngest, trying to get her to the point where she can swim. It finally dawned on me, probably my life-saving measures are counterproductive. Because if you see what kids wear now to the pool, it's like a life jacket and floaties, and it's combined. It's the same. It gives kind of the same look when you put them in too many clothes to go play in the snow, and they walk like this. It's the same look. So I put her in the water and I said, "Now swim, you got to do this." And so she's trying, and "Daddy, I can't do it." But there's one thing that really has caused her to struggle, and that is jumping in the water in the deep end. Jumping in the water in the deep end. And you remember how it was when you were growing up, your dad got you out to the edge of the pool and gave you a kick, and you fell in. He said, "Swim." And my dad's in the room, so that makes this more fun. So that we're not doing that. I'm just trying to get her to jump in. I'm down there. I'm standing. It's 5 feet of water, and she quizzes me, "Daddy, how are you standing?" And so I immediately go, "Well, Jesus walked on water." And so now I said, "No, it's Daddy can stand. I can reach the bottom. I'm taller than the water." I'm going to go through all this explanation, and she keeps saying, "Well, what about this? What about that? And you promise you're not going to let go." And so I'm doing everything I can, and then I start demanding that she jump. "Just jump now. The lifeguard is looking at me. This is getting weird. Just jump." And so after all this coaxing, it finally dawns on me what she actually needs. So I get her to come sit at the edge of the pool, and I get her life jacket, and I look her right in the eyes, and I say, "Daddy's never going to let anything happen to you. You can jump in." And of course, it's like a magic trick, right? And she says, "Okay, I'll jump." But she needed what we need. She needed to know, can I really trust you? And so her way of examining that was to quiz me on all these other variables. So finally, what she really needed was to know she could trust the person there. So if you read through the Gospels, that idea that you can trust the person comes out more often, is more forceful than the instruction you receive. So when I say the Gospels, I'm talking about Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. When you read through those, there's actually very little instruction on how to be a Christian. You get little snippets like the Sermon on the Mount, but generally speaking, word for word, the percentage of instruction is pretty small. Most of it is about Jesus as God, and you can trust him. Here's the evidence. That's most of the Gospels. In fact, that's most of the Bible is saying. Here's God. You can trust him. That message is brought out over and over and over again. Because what we need is that moment, sitting on the edge of the pool, God looking us right in the eyes and saying, "You know you can trust me, right?" That apparently is what we need more than any ounce of instruction. That is the same thing that guides most things in life. Instruction is not the struggle. Having our hearts won over is the struggle. Why are we not all skinnier? Is it that we don't get the idea you should eat less? We all know that's the point, that's the problem, so to speak. Getting our heart in the right place, that's the challenge. Why are you not wealthier? We all know you should spend less than you take in, and you'll have more in the savings account. That's not the getting our heart in the right place is the problem. So this happens over and over again in life. So what happens in the Gospels is Jesus is saying, "I'm working harder to get your heart in the right place than for you to know the proper set of propositions." That is absolutely the case with the passage we're going to look at this morning. Jesus is going to come hard after your heart through through this passage this morning. So Mark chapter 6, two stories together. Mark chapter 6, we'll begin reading in verse 45. As you find that passage, Mark 6, 45, would you stand together as we read out of reverence for the Word of God? Mark chapter 6, 45. Immediately, he made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, to Bethsaida, while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had taken leave of them, he went up on the mountain to pray. And when evening came, the boat was out to sea, and he was alone on the land. And he saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. And about the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. He meant to pass by them, but when they saw him walking on the sea, they thought it was a ghost and cried out, for they all saw him and were terrified. But immediately he spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." And he got into the boat with them, and the wind ceased, and they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. When they had crossed over, they came to the Gennesaret and moored to the shore. And when they got out of the boat, the people immediately recognized him and ran about the whole region and began to bring the sick people on their beds to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he came, in villages, cities, or countryside, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and implored him that they might touch even the fringe of his garment. And as many as touched it were made well. Let's pray. Father, as we look at these two stories together, one infamously famous, Father, I pray that we would not seek to just gain some new pragmatic tool we might use this week. Father, by your Spirit, would you win over hearts in this room? Father, I suspect some need to be won over for the first time, but I also anticipate most fall in the camp of the disciples that we need to be won over all again. Would you do that for me? Would you do that for every person who hears my voice? And it's in your Son's name I pray. Amen. Please be seated. Jesus does something to demonstrate that he is God. So here's the passage in a nutshell. We're going to see that Jesus is God. I suspect maybe even in a little bit different way than you might anticipate first off. We're going to see Jesus is God on the one hand. Then we're going to see just three ways to trust him. But that is why he's doing this walking on the water. Is he wants his followers, you, to trust him. So who God is, and then that we should trust him. Hopefully, if you were here last week, that concept sounds familiar. Who God is, and three ways we should trust him. Because these stories build off of one another. In particular, the story of Jesus walking on the water is in direct correlation to what we read last week with the feeding of the 5,000. So last week ended with Jesus has fed 5,000. His disciples are won over by the miraculous nature of it. They each have a basket of more bread than the 5 loaves and 2 fish they started with. And so they are all each individually being persuaded who Jesus is, that he is this leader. He is, as Jesus' terms, this shepherd worth following. But the crowd has also decided he is a revolutionary leader that is going to take the reign politically and overthrow Herod Antipas. He's going to overthrow Philip and Tiberius. He's going to overthrow Rome ultimately. So Jesus, in that moment, has to get his disciples out of Dodge. So he puts them on a boat and sends them out. They're gone. He gets them out of there, and then he, according to John, has to escape the crowd wanting to make him king, has to escape the crowd, and so Mark tells us he heads up on a mountain to pray. He gets away from this crowd. So then, we see the miracle of Jesus walking on the water take place. So I suspect it's not the first time you've heard Jesus walked on water. No one gasped when I read that portion of the passage. Here's what I need to do to kind of lay this out, I think, as faithfully as I can. I want to show you two layers to this story. Mark, inspired by the Holy Spirit, is a literary genius. Here's what I mean by that. He writes on two layers at the same time. In one sense, Mark is the simplest gospel. If you read through Mark and you just want to get the basic story of Jesus' life, Mark is the simplest. At the same time, he is putting in phrases and ideas that seem odd and a little out of place. And that's intended to catch our eye. It's intended to catch our minds and say, why is that there? And then when we dig into each of those components, we get this whole other second layer, this deeper meaning of the same story. So let me show you both of those. So first is the miraculous, physical, obvious Jesus walked on top of the water. But in case you've watched the History Channel lately, let me shoot down, just real fast, a couple myths. I believe Jesus literally, his feet stepped on top of the Sea of Galilee, and each step, the water became as concrete below him. He manipulated the physical properties of the water to make it solidified with each step. That's what I believe took place in this miracle, in this story. The broader world doesn't believe that. So what they've done is they've said, you know what? We want to give the Bible its due. We want to give the Bible its due. And so we want to think about this maybe in a way that is more logical to a scientific mind and understand how could the disciples have been won over or duped into thinking Jesus walked on water. So here's the first idea. They'll say this is an optical illusion. It's at night. It's at night, the light coming down from the night sky. Jesus was actually walking on the shore, but in low lighting, it appeared as if he were walking to them on the water. It appeared. Now, there are a number of reasons for why this idea would fall apart. I would suggest to you the primary one is these are fishermen who, as you see elsewhere in the Gospels, usually fish at night. If you're used to being out on the lake at night, you're used to seeing people, other fishermen, walk along the shore at night, you are probably not going to be fooled by Jesus. Secondarily, it says Jesus saw them in the midst of the lake, or the Sea of Galilee. So they're out in the middle. So for experienced fishermen, the idea that this is an optical illusion and he's really just on the shore, you can probably throw that one out. That one doesn't get a lot of credence. The second one is that Jesus was walking on a piece of land, like a sandbar. He was walking on a piece of land, and so they'll take you out and they'll do kind of this computer animated thing, and you'll get to see via video on the History Channel, Jesus would have walked on this sandbar. It would have appeared that he was on the Sea of Galilee. How do we know that's not the case? Well, you mean the easiest point of evidence is, again, experienced fishermen would have known where sandbars were. But let me give you a second piece of evidence you weren't counting on. I've been there to the Sea of Galilee on a boat recently. Here's the thing. You say, well, brother, why does that matter? Maybe the sandbar or the land has changed over time. This is 2,000 years later. Let me tell you why that matters. You know, in February, the Israeli government released a memo to the public that they are going to try to protect the Sea of Galilee. Right now, they're making efforts to protect it. You know how they need to protect it? It's shrinking. The water level has been going down for years. to the point that they are starting to get nervous that the shrinking water level will mess up their tourist attraction. Because if you go to Israel and you're a Christian, what do you want to see? Where Jesus walked on water. So they're nervous about it. So here's the thing. I went out on a boat to a shrunken lake, a lake that's way down. The lake being way down, you know what you still don't see? Sandbars. Right now, we have a vantage point people in history have not had. The lake's so far down, they're getting nervous about it. And there's still nothing you could walk on. It's still 141 feet deep. So we begin to throw out these little theories for why we would say Jesus didn't walk on water. So here's what I think we have to say. You could say the Bible's lying. You could put all those things out there. It's endless kind of objections to why I believe this. So here's where I am this morning. Here's what me moving forward. Is Jesus actually physically walked across, as the Bible describes, on top, on the sea? He walked on it. So just for some in the room, that's my starting point. I think there's the only evidence is eyewitness. But there would not be any other evidence other than eyewitness. So that's the first layer. Jesus actually walked on water. Here's the conclusion the disciples come to in the Gospel of Matthew. From that event, you are God. Matthew chapter 14, they say, this must be the Son of God. If you see someone able to manipulate nature to that degree, the conclusion, most natural conclusion, is this is somebody beyond humanity. This is God. Mark doesn't bring out that ending like Matthew does. Mark tells us more subtly. Remember I said he's literary genius. So let me tell you how Mark says it more subtly. He wants us to absolutely see that this is something only God can do. So he has this odd phrase that stands out. So Jesus is walking on the water towards the disciples. And then it says, and he meant to pass by them. Did you notice that? The end of verse 48. He meant to pass by them. What does that mean? Now, if you're reading it like I did for years, it sounds like Jesus is trying to be sneaky and he's really bad at it. Do you see that? Jesus is walking across the water. It's kind of like when you were in the grocery store. And you saw your pastor a couple aisles over, and you started to avoid him. You think, oh, goodness, don't want to talk to that guy. So, or maybe you've been in the grocery store, and there's that really chipper person that's always excited, and you think, it's been too long a day. And so you start to avoid them, and you're going down opposite aisles till you see that they saw you. Then you can't keep avoiding them. You know that they saw you. They saw you see them. So what do you have to do now? Now you have to go talk to them or it's awkward. It kind of gives that impression with this story. Jesus out strolling the lake, hoping not to be noticed, and wants to pass by them when all of a sudden they spot him. And so he thinks, oh, well, this is awkward. So he has to go over and it's just me, you guys. So it reads that way at first. That would be an odd thing. For God of the universe, he's capable of walking across the lake, but he's not capable of being unseen. That didn't make any sense. So why add the phrase in? He meant to pass by them. That phrase is unique. It's unique in terms of the Bible. It's unique specifically in terms of the Old Testament. It's unique even more specifically in terms of that is a phrase used for when God reveals his glory. Let me show you what I mean. Exodus chapter 32, verse 21. In Exodus 33, Moses wants to see God. He wants to see him. So God says, if you actually saw me, it would destroy you. So he says, I'm going to hide you in the cleft of this rock, and I'm going to pass by you. So here's what he says in Exodus 33:21. And the Lord said, behold, there is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock. And while my glory passes by, I will put you in the cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. The way of exposing the glory of God is described as that peculiar phrase, pass by. Again, Exodus 34, verse 6 says, the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, a God, merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. So when God reveals who he is, it's this description, but it's done when he passes before him. 1 Kings 19, verse 11. And he said, go out and stand on the mount. So this is Elijah wanting to hear a message from God. And God says, I'm going to deliver a message. Go out and stand on this mount. And it's a rather famous passage from 1 Kings 19. It says, go out and stand on this mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by. And a great strong wind tore the mountains in broken pieces and rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, and the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of a low whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he knows the Lord has passed by. This phrase comes up over and over again, describing when God has revealed himself to humanity. And it keeps using this phrase, the Lord has passed by. But let me give you the place that I think is the most evidentiary for us. It comes in Job chapter 9, verses 8 and 11. 9:8. Who alone stretched out the heavens and trampled the waves of the sea? Sound familiar? Verse 11. Behold, he passes by me. When God walks on the water to reveal his character and nature, to show himself as all of his splendor, he does so trampling the waves of the sea in such a way that he passes by. Mark is bringing up that language for this conclusion, that what this miracle indicates is God of all eternity stood on the water before the disciples. The best way to say that is not to say God of eternity stood water. The best way to say that is God did what God always does, and you go back and read all these stories where he's passed by, and this is another occasion for you to see, I to see. Jesus absolutely is God. And he's revealing who he is to his disciples. And they're terrified by it. They're terrified, and so what does he say? Now, let me give you a critique of the version I'm reading from. I looked up several other versions. They all do virtually the same thing. When they're terrified, in verse 50, he says, take heart, it is I. It is I. If you've got a little way to note in your Bible, it is I is the only good way of saying that in English. In the original language, in the Greek, he says, ego a me. Ego a me is a way of saying, I am. That's literally, that's what it means. Ego, I. You can use ego for I am. You can use a me for I am. So I would suggest to you what he's saying is, I am, I am. Take heart, I am. Where else do you hear, Bible student in the room, where else do you hear God saying, I am? Moses says, what's your name? What's your name to God? And in Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, he says, I am who I am. That's my name. I'm an ever-present being. I am God. So when Jesus comes before them, walking on the water, and they are terrified, and they're shocked, and they think it's a ghost, he says, let your heart not be troubled. I am God. I am here. He's declaring himself to be God in the moment. Nobody else says, I am. Try that. Try it. Next time you're using the bathroom at your house, somebody knocks on the door. I am. Sitting on a throne, you might as well. Oh, I'm sorry. So that idea, though, he's declaring it. It doesn't work. It doesn't make sense. Mark is giving us these little tidbits of these phrases that he's wanting us to go to this deeper level and see. Not only does the miracle display who Jesus is, Jesus is using the miracle to display that he is God of the universe. The same God of the Old Testament. The same God that led the people out of Israel. The same God who revealed himself to the prophet Elijah. The same God who Job finally learned to count on. Jesus is claiming to be all of that. The disciples are shocked. The word in our translation this morning is they're astounded. So here's where we make the shift. That's who Jesus is. He's God on display. There's no other way to describe it. They're astounded. Is being astounded in that moment right or wrong? Would you be astounded? Look what Mark does, though. He says it's wrong. In verse 51, and he got into the boat with them, and the wind ceased. And they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. They were utterly astounded, and the reason they were astounded, he says, for they didn't get the last miracle, and they had hard hearts. That's why they were astounded. That's a weird ending to that story. Jesus walks on the water. Their hearts are hard. How do we put that together? How do we understand? So here's what he says. Let's get astounded in our mind's eye. Astounded is not excited. It is in shock, trying to grasp reality as astounded, the word behind it. It's like if somebody were sleepwalking. You ever heard? I've always been told I've been wanting to run into somebody sleepwalking. It hasn't happened yet because they say, don't wake them up while they're sleepwalking. Just let them go back to bed. You know what that makes me want to do? And just wake them up to see what happens. But somebody sleepwalking wakes up and they're shocked. How did I get here? What's going on? And that moment, they're astounded. That's the meaning there. They can't process what's going on. Just like somebody sleepwalking would be in a moment of disbelief. That's where they are. You know another way of saying somebody who disbelieves Jesus? They have a hard heart. That same phrase, hard heart, is used in Mark chapter 3, verse 5, when it's talking about the rulers in the synagogue. They are described as having hard hearts also. They don't believe. So if we would be astounded by this miracle, we are described as Mark as having a hard heart. Now, before we can make sense of that, we have to add in something else. We're going to make it a little bit worse. So I've seen Jesus as God on earth walking on water, and I shouldn't be astounded by it. How does that make sense? That's what we're after. The way to make sense of it is to look at the same story in Matthew. So Matthew chapter 14. Matthew at first seems to have a contradictory ending. So Matthew, Jesus walking on water in verse 22, very similar. Immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowd. Almost literally the same wording through this section. But by the verse 24, by the boat, by the time, was a long way off from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. So it's the same idea. The only thing he adds in is Peter gets out of the boat. Mark eliminates that because Mark is writing from Peter's perspective. So Peter picks and chooses what goes in about himself. So Mark eliminates that. But look down to how it ends this time. Same story. Verse 31. Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him and saying, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. Look at verse 33, their reaction. And those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." Seemingly, two completely different reactions. Same story. Why would Matthew say he gets into the boat and they say, "You're the Son of God"? And Mark say he gets into the boat and their hearts were hard. Sounds like they're grumpy. We're still mad about the bread. That's what Mark writes. They didn't understand the loaves. What I think is we put the two stories together. Put these two stories together in this sense. Matthew says they were in awe of Jesus. "You are the Son of God." That was historically also present in Mark's account. What Mark is that instead of being in awe of Jesus, they should have expected it because he had already done something to display he was God with the loaves. Now follow me on this. What should have happened in that moment is they should have seen Jesus come across the water, been surprised. What is that coming across the water? But when they see that it's Jesus, said, "Oh, that makes complete sense." Then you say, that seems like a stretch. What Mark is telling us is if they had fully comprehended Jesus revealing himself as God with the loaves, then that same idea would have popped into their mind when Jesus approached them across the water in the boat. He's already demonstrated he is God. For him to do something like this, it is surprising, but it doesn't shock me in the least. Because the Jesus I have come to know does miraculous things when we're in difficult moments. But they missed it with the loaves. So even when he's in the boat, they still find it unbelievable that he is God. They had missed it. Their hearts were hardened. We know this. People you get to know may have little quirks about them, but you get to know it, so it doesn't surprise you. So just for instance, if you went to my wife and you said, "Mitch is in his office eating the spiciest pepper in the world. He's really red in the face and sweating profusely." She would say, "Well, can you tell him to hurry up? We got to go." Because she knows me. She knows that's not a weird, it's a weird thing. I mean, I admit that. But she knows for me it's not a weird thing. She knows me. She's not taken back by it. If they had really gotten to know Jesus in the loaves, for him to show up across the water would have clicked. Something should have triggered, but it didn't. Because they still didn't believe in him like they should. So here's the question for us. Here's where our three things come together. What is it about the feeding of the 5,000 that should have made walking on water predictable? What is it about feeding 5,000 people that makes walking on water predictable? Here's what Jesus is doing. The same things. I'm going to show you. Three, they're very quick, but there are three little spots that are the same. Three things from the feeding of the 5,000 that make walking on the water predictable. Here's what Jesus is really doing. He's emphasizing these three characteristics. He just showed them with the loaves. Then he's emphasizing it again. And he's not doing it in a mean way. He's doing it in a way that says, I want you to see this. Here's what I'm saying. Jesus got into that boat, held them by their life jacket and said, do you see it? Do you trust me now? Jesus wants us to see it. So let me show you these three things just real quickly. The first one, difficulty is an opportunity from God. So in Mark, he told us that at evening, Jesus sent the disciples off. He sends the disciples off in the boat, and then by the fourth watch of the night, they're in the midst of the sea. Let me give you a little time reference. Evening was before 9 p.m. Late in the day, but before 9 p.m. According to the way the Romans counted time. So before 9 p.m., fourth watch of the night is 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. So you're talking about 8 to 10 hours. 8 to 10 hours to cross the edge of the, it's a big lake. Really, we could go out in a rowboat, without exaggeration, and cross it in a couple hours. Leisurely. It takes them 8 to 10 hours. Some people have said, Jesus walked on water. I believe that. But that it took them 8 to 10 hours to cross the water, that's just unbelievable. What I think they're missing is the slowness of water is also miraculous. Jesus is intentionally making this an impossible task. It's an everyday thing, but he has made it so difficult. Jesus is intentionally allowing these guys to come to an impossible moment. Now follow me. Here's why we need to see this. Here's where we learn to trust Jesus. Some of us have in our minds that when difficulty comes in our life, God is in the silver lining. God's in the silver lining. That's where he is in the midst of a storm. What I'm telling you is that Jesus caused this storm. God is not just in the silver lining. God's in the entire dark cloud. That's the only explanation for why it took them 8 to 10 hours to cross this lake. It's because God was preventing it. So please, hear me on this. You will continue to struggle to believe in God until you acknowledge that he is not just the silver lining, he is the whole thing. That when we face difficulty in our life, that is the occasion in which God works. And he has allowed it to take place. Because what we usually think at difficult moments is God has abandoned me. What Jesus is teaching these disciples is difficult moments is when I'm most present. So as long as we have difficult moments equal God's abandoned me, you have a hard heart. Because what happened in the difficulty of feeding the 5,000? When it became that everybody's hungry, that's when Jesus put himself on display through his disciples. When they've struggled all night. There's been times in my life that I think I've ended up in an impossible situation, largely out of my control. Sometimes that has frustrated me to death. And I'll fuss about it with God. There have been a handful of times it's clicked. It's clicked. In the moment, I think, you know what? I think God's doing something. I think he's doing something. And what has happened when it's clicked is my eyes have been opened, and it's a moment of faith growing. The other times, my heart's been hard. The second thing, Jesus provides. With the feeding of the 5,000, he asked his disciples to go feed 5,000. They said, that's impossible. It would take 200 denarii. It would take $17,000 to go feed this many people. A cheap meal. We can't do that. Jesus says, no, feed them. What do you have? So then he provides what they need to carry that task out. What happened in this situation? Jesus said, I'm going to put you in a boat. Go over to this other side. When they get stuck and they're unable to carry out what Jesus has asked them to do? What does he do? He comes to them and provides what they need for them to get to the other side. What happened when he entered the boat? The wind ceased. Jesus always provides what you need to do what he's called you to do. If you're following his leadership, he provides what you need to follow him. To do what he has called you to do. He showed them that in the feeding of the 5,000. Now he's down eye to eye, saying, do you see it? I'm reiterating this. I'm emphasizing this because you have to know what I've called you to do, I will provide for. Lastly, Jesus comes to us in our time of need. Jesus comes to us when we have to have him. That idea got missed in the feeding of the 5,000. That idea got missed on the lake. Here's the logic. Their hearts are hard. They're not believing in Jesus. So what do they believe? What do they believe? You don't believe in Jesus, the truth. That means de facto you believe a lie. What's the lie we tell ourselves? God's not going to bend heaven and earth to come to me. God's not going to manipulate all of nature just to solve my little problem. What did he do at the feeding of the 5,000? He manipulated exactly nature, caused bread to multiply, fish to multiply. He manipulated it to meet the need. When they're out, having that difficulty crossing the lake, he comes out to them because he wants them to see in miraculous form that when you are in a difficult moment, I am there for you. I am there for you. Let me get all the Christians in the room for just a moment. If you're a follower of Jesus, currently, right now. You have more proof than those disciples did. More proof than when they saw Jesus walk across the lake. Listen to this verse. Romans chapter 8, verse 32. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? You don't have Jesus walking across the lake to demonstrate it to you. You have Jesus hanging on a cross to demonstrate it to you. That he will graciously give us all things. What we need is to recognize Jesus on that cross is a moment of God sitting down in front of you. Jesus on the cross is that moment where he's got you right there. He's holding on to the collar of your jacket. He's looking you in the eye. And Jesus says, look at me. Look at me. Do you not see that if I was willing to die for you, that I'm also going to provide for you in every other way? If I'm willing to give up my life to give you eternal life, why am I going to let you go in another moment? Jesus is saying, trust me. Trust me. I think that heart position of trusting him is one of the most difficult things. We're very pragmatic people. We say, tell me what to do. We can say what you need to do to be a Christian all day long. I think the hang up for us is that very idea. I can trust him. Do you trust him? Are there still moments like the disciples of hard hearts because I haven't put it all the way together? And if you're not a follower of Jesus and things like walking on water have given you a hang up, the guys don't know if I can buy into all that. Let me encourage you, a place to start is more that Romans 8:32 idea. He was crucified in your place. Somebody's willing to die for you, you can probably trust. I think you could trust in him today. If you want to know what that looks like, how to take that first step of trust, we're going to sing this final song together. I'm here this morning. We'll begin a conversation, not to put you on the spot in any way, but to say, here's what trusting him initially looks like. For all the believers in the room, I would encourage you to be honest this morning. Is there a place where, like the disciples, I've had a little bit of a hard heart, I have not trusted him fully? What does that look like for you this morning? Would you stand together as we sing this final song?